Welcome to our immigration podcast. This is a podcast we do once a week where we summarize the immigration news, which has occurred recently, and give people some information about some of the programs and how immigration works, and also answer questions. If you've got friends or family or anybody who might be interested in immigration, send them over to our site. On our channel, we've got tons of videos, but we also do lots of updates like this podcast every week. All right, in today's podcast, we're going to be covering the Build Back Better bill. We're going to touch on the E2 visa and how that works and what it does. We'll talk about the new travel restriction under the Omicron COVID variant that's come out. And we'll answer a handful of questions we've got from our listeners. All right. If you want to jump ahead, take a look down. We'll have some links that'll show you where you can click and jump ahead to other topics. Here we go. So the House passed a bill called Build Back Better. Now, I know we have the infrastructure bill, and I know this might sound confusing, but Build Back Better is a completely separate bill. The House passed this bill, and the bill does contain specific immigration provisions. At this point, this bill is in front of the Senate, and the Senate's going to have to vote on it to decide what's in and what's out. Now, in regards to immigration, what we're really focused on is a handful of things, which we're going to show you right here. There's about four or five different things inside this bill that actually will address some of the ongoing immigration problems we've had for the last four to five years. Specifically, what we're looking at is a provisional work permit for undocumented people known as parole. It's a parole, is what it's called, and it's a work permit, and it's designed for people who've been here on average more than 20 years, okay? So it's a provision that kind of says, hey, let's let you come out of the shadows so you can at least work, but at the same time, doesn't give anybody really anything. It doesn't give them the right to vote or become a resident or have permission to live here. It's just a way for them to be functioning members of society, all right? So long-standing individuals who've been here a long time get the ability to work legally under this parole program. Essentially, we're looking at a different part of the bill of giving a 10-year period that's going to grant a benefit to more people. And this is mostly undocumented individuals who arrived in the United States prior to January 1, 2011. So this was something we talked about a long time ago. There's a law called Registry. It's an old law. It's on the books. And it basically says anybody who came to the United States before 1972 and has lived here continuously can just automatically get a green card. Yeah, this is a law. It's on the books. It's called Registry. And the way Registry works is just be a person of good moral character and then prove you lived here on a date specific. So they've been playing around with Registry, and one of the ideas that was floated, and it was floated actually by a think tank called the Cato Institute, was to just change the Registry law and make the new date January 2011. So at this point, this bill is in some shape or form addressing that by saying, let's choose this date, let's choose this law, and see if we can include more people in it. So we're going to find out more about that if this bill comes to a Senate vote and if they get to a committee, right? The conference committee, if they have to actually make these things, settle the details on it. We're going to find out more about that. But for now, that's a really good provision. And we've liked that provision because we like the way it addresses some of the very, very big problems we have in immigration right now. In addition, we have a couple of provisions that will give undocumented workers an ability to work in the United States. And this includes a lot of different people like TPS and other people who have lived in the United States and worked here under a long period of time. But again, it's a provision that's going to give them permission to work and live for a short period of time. And the most important thing here is that these provisions were designed to get past the Senate parliamentarian. If you follow the politics of what's been going on, is that a Senate parliamentarian is a specific office in the Senate that looks very, very closely at each bill to make sure all the provisions that are added on actually relate to the bill and do not increase any government spending. So these things are very kind of arcane and very specific, and to be honest with you, I don't know exactly what they're looking for in this bill, but they've designed it so that the Senate parliamentarian should be able to approve these provisions. We'll be addressing this every week as we learn more about it, but these few main facts are kind of important if you're following immigration now and want to know where things are going. All right, so we get a lot of questions about different kinds of visas, and one visa that's actually a really, really good program is the E visa. The E visa is very specific. It's only for countries that have a treaty with the United States called a treaty of commerce. So we've got a list of about 75 or 80 countries that have treaties in the United States. And under this treaty, individuals from those specific countries can get a visa called either an E1 or an E2. Today we're going to talk about the E2. The E2 visa is a provision which allows people to invest money in the United States, open a business or buy a new business, and then live and work in the United States. Now, this is an excellent way for entrepreneurs or business owners who live in any of these countries to bring capital or bring their actual business, the one they actually run, open a branch, open a new one, sell a business, open something similar in the United States, and get permission to live and work. The E2 visa allows the owner itself to come as an E2, and the spouse and children also get visas, and as a bonus, they actually get work permits. It's one of the very few visas where the spouse is given a work permit. So believe it or not, I've got lots of clients who love this visa. Most specifically, they like is that while one family member runs the business, the other family member can actually be out working with a work permit and a normal job. The visa is designed for family members to come. The only thing is that it's not specifically leading to a green card. Now, this is kind of confusing. People get lost on that because there's an investment-based green card. But that's completely separate. That's actually a different program and has different requirements. But an E2 on its own can get sponsored by another business or a family member, or the wife. Oftentimes, we see a spouse with the work permit going out, getting a job, and then getting sponsored to get the green card that way. Some of those things are kind of detailed and specific. Talk to a lawyer about them if you have questions. But the E2 visa is an excellent visa, and I do tons of those every year from entrepreneurs all over the world. We've got the new travel ban announcement. All right, the Omicron variant came out in South Africa last week, a small number of cases. We're hearing a lot of different news, and I think what we've seen is a preemptive action by the American government to stop travel to from about 7 or 8 different countries in South Africa, including the country of South Africa, to come to the United States. What you need to know is this. Right now, there's a travel ban. That ban affects Botswana, Eswatini, Lesotho, Malawi, Mozambique, Namibia, South Africa, and Zimbabwe. If anybody is traveling from those countries to the United States, they're going to have a big problem, meaning you can't come. If you visited those countries 14 days prior to coming to the United States, same thing. You're not going to be allowed to enter the United States. Of course, the travel ban always has exceptions for United States citizens or if you're a green card holder. Now, you're going to have to be looking at some of the provisions that we see right now that were implemented November 8th, which is coming to the United States, you have to show a vaccination and a negative test, right? So right now, if you're a citizen and you live in London and you want to come to the United States, you have to actually show your vaccination as well as a negative COVID test within 72 hours of boarding a flight, okay? 72 hours prior to boarding a flight. So I'm sure that this travel announcement is going to be very similar. Now, we're going to see what happens with this, and we'll update you guys more on it, because some of the travel announcements seem to be kind of early. We don't know a lot about the Omicron variant. We do know that there's cases already around the world, so maybe a travel ban might not be effective. We'll have more news for you soon on that. All right, we've got comments and questions today. We're going to hit them up right now so you guys can check these out. So one of the questions I have right here is with the O-1 visa, can you do side jobs or extra jobs or other kind of work? Are you limited to being, this question says, a physician at one hospital? Okay, so to answer that question very, very sort of generally, the way the O-1 works is that if you are sponsored by an employer to work at that company, then your O-1 only allows you to do that, to work at that company. It gets confusing, and the reason this question even exists is because a lot of O-1s are in fields where they're allowed to work in multiple professions, but it's a specific type of filing. It means that there's an agent who filed the case, and they gave an itinerary and a sort of breakdown of all the locations someone's going to be working. So it depends on your O-1. Talk to your attorney, figure out how it was set up, and if you do want to expand and work in more locations, it's possible to set up a new O-1 either as a renewal or even now, change your O-1 so you can have multiple work locations. I recommend that for people. And you know what? Good attorneys plan that in advance, and that's something you should bring up with them right away. All right? Next question I've got is, I filed an extension 2 months ago. My EAD and I-94 expired. Can I still work? Right now, USCIS allows an automatic extension of 180 days, okay, 6 months, for EAD renewals that are timely filed. Okay? You filed that thing on time, then yes, you're eligible to continue to work under your previous I-9 with your expired card for a period of 180 days. All right, talk to your employer about that. Show them the rule. It's on the USCIS website. All right. All right. Can a DACA recipient get sponsored by an H-1B visa? This question can be read many, many different ways, so I'll try and read it the most literal way and give you guys the most specific answer. Can a DACA recipient get something sponsored, I think means green card, from an H-1B visa? So that's very complicated. So DACA recipients can be sponsored by any business or company in the United States. In fact, we talk about that a lot because it is one of the ways that DACA recipients can take advantage of the current laws and get a green card now. So can DACA recipients be sponsored by a company? Yes. Can DACA recipients be sponsored by a company that also sponsors H-1Bs? Yes. Can an H-1B individual marry a DACA and then change them to an H-4, spouse of an H-1B? That will depend on the facts of your case. You're going to have to see an attorney about that. That's very, very, very specific because it relies on your unlawful presence and some other things, okay? And if I just look at it just generally, can a DACA recipient get sponsored to be an H-1B by another company in the United States? You see this question so vague. That's also a possible, right? So if an American company and they already hired you and they want you to be an H-1B, it's possible for you to actually be turn into an H-1B. All right? Possible. Talk to your lawyer about that. All right, I got one more question here. This is our last question, and we'll wrap it up. Can you go from H-2B to green card or TPS? All right. Short answer to that is it's possible. The problem is H-2B is so short and so limited, 9 months, 10 months. We've seen the extension up to 18 months right now, that the timing of it is very hard to fit into a seamless transfer to other things. What you can do with an H-2B, and I tell people this all the time, is that you've got a U.S. sponsor and you're working as an H-2B, a seasonal peak load, intermittent employee, you can turn that into something. So for sure you can turn it into a green card. The process for the green card just takes 2 years. So if you say, can I turn it into my H-2B into a green card? Well, there's going to be a gap in time. All right. So the main problem with H-2B, it's got a limitation on the amount of time, usually 9 months. Right now, like I said, we've seen it up to 18 months. And you have to go home in the meantime. So lots of possibilities, but do you need to, but can you do it? Yes. You just need to work with your attorney, set all that up, and feel comfortable about what you're doing and know your plan. One of the things we do here, and I do it all the time, is make sure people know that there's a detailed plan that involves you going home. It's not just, oh, can I do this? Sure, let's get started. It has to have a plan because for green cards to get granted, to win these visas, do other things, you have to know the whole process from start to finish, all right? And that's it for this week. I hope you enjoyed our podcast. We do this every week. Send your friends, send your family, ask us questions. We're always here to answer. And if you really want to talk to me, you can set an appointment up with us. We'll do a telephone consult or in person as well. All right, stay safe out there. Take care. Bye.